Welcome to Escape to the Country. Now today, I'm on a hunt. Not for a house, well not just yet, but rather for this, a gravestone. And as you can probably just make out, this is the final resting place of one Ebenezer Scrooge. Now, as we all know, he was, of course, a fictitious character invented by Charles Dickens. So, why is this here and where is it? Well, join me in just a few moments and I'll tell you.
On today's show, I'll be helping two adventurous house hunters leave behind the confined spaces of their housing estate to set up base camp in the great outdoors of the open countryside. And they don't pull any punches.
It's quite small, isn't it?
But in one house, there's no hiding their delight.
Look at the smiles on your face. This is all good,
yeah. I like it.
Well, today we're in Shropshire, and this is the graveyard of St. Chad's Church in the middle of Shrewsbury. Now, of course, dear old Ebenezer's gravestone is a fake. In fact, it was a movie prop left behind after the making of the 1984 film, A Christmas Carol. Now, as you can appreciate, since then, it's become something of a local tourist attraction. But the good news is, well, there's a lot more to this county than just the fiction.
Situated in the West Midlands, the landlocked county of Shropshire is sandwiched between Wales to the west and Staffordshire to the east. The county is a rural idyll, rich in agricultural land and classic English countryside, dotted with picturesque postcard villages and towns like Much Wenlock and Ludlow. Through its middle runs the majestic River Severn, splitting the county in half with rippling fields above it and rolling hills and deep valleys below, much of which have been selected as areas of outstanding natural beauty. All of which belies the county's industrial past. Shropshire is known as the birthplace of the Industrial Revolution, symbolised by the world's first iron structure spanning the River Severn at Ironbridge Gorge, now a UNESCO World Heritage Site. No wonder, then, that this county remains an attraction to tourists and property hunters alike.
Now, I love coming to Shropshire. It offers the sort of rural living that most of us aspire to. The perfect place, you could say, to escape to the country. But the real icing on the cake is the property prices. Now, your average detached here will set you back £237,000. And yes, it is a lot of money, but consider this, it's £19,000 less than the national figure and £25,000 less than what you'd have to pay for the same sort of thing in neighbouring Worcestershire. So the lesson is clear. Shropshire, with all its charm and tranquility and affordability, is a really good bet, which is exactly why, of course, today's buyers want to be here.
For the past 4 years, fireman Ross and climbing instructor Wendy have been living on a tight-knit estate in Knowsall, Staffordshire, but feel they've outgrown their three-bed semi, and now is the time to make the move to a more private countryside location.
Where we live at the moment is on an estate. There are other houses that overlook the garden, so our ideal property would be out in the open with its own land, not overlooked or near a busy road.
We've kind of outlived this house. It's a little bit too small.
And the destination for their relocation is dictated by their outdoor pursuits.
We're looking to move into Shropshire around the Much Wenlock area. There's plenty of walking and climbing in that area, so that would be our ideal location.
Weekends are brilliant, and on a Friday we can just get everything into the camper van and head off with Alfie the dog, go climbing or kayaking, take the bikes.
We're travelling to Wales most weekends and then travelling to work during the week, and Shropshire would basically be halfway between the two.
But all their hobbies come with a lot of kit.
The must-haves for our new property would be space for our car and camper van. We've also got my kit car, so somewhere to keep that under dry storage. And if possible, somewhere for my dinghy, which during the winter needs to be stored, so that would be great. Also, space to store all the climbing kit, buoyancy aids and ropes and associated equipment would be great.
Not all of their interests are so physical.
Last year, I was taught how to knit, and I've always been interested in it. and actually been able to combine that with the love of climbing, and I've produced some knitted climbing equipment as keyrings, which have been popular amongst climbers.
All that's left to discover are the financial details.
The budget for this move would be around £210,000.
Ross and Wendy have asked us to concentrate our search around the town of Much Wenlock, halfway between work commitments in Nosal, Staffordshire, and outdoor adventures in Wales. But before we start our search, I caught up with them in Shropshire to find out what they're looking for in a new home.
Hi, Wendy. Hello, Ross.
Hi.
Nice to see you two.
Yeah.
Now then, this is all rather exciting, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah. You must be one of the youngest couples we've ever had on Escape to the Country.
You are a tall guy, and your classic little country cottage might challenge you.
Yeah, there is a good chance there. That's why we're looking for something a little bit different, a little bit quirky, off the beaten track a little bit, something that we can make our own.
So, bedrooms-wise,
two to three.
Two to three.
Lots of outdoor space, barns and so on. You have got quite a bit of stuff, haven't you?
Yeah.
Mountain bikes.
Yeah.
A dinghy.
Yeah.
Canoes.
Yeah.
This is going to be good fun.
Yeah.
I look forward to this. Right then, shall we get going? We've got three properties to show you, including the mystery house. Who knows what could happen?
Brilliant. Exactly.
Let's go through the magic archway. After you, Wendy.
For a budget of £210,000, Ross and Wendy are looking for 2 to 3 bedrooms. A property with individual character. Plenty of storage space for their outdoor equipment. A garage to house a dinghy, Ross's kit car, as well as parking space for the camper van. And all in a quiet village location, ideally midway between Staffordshire and Wales. We have three different prospects for them today, with varying degrees of potential, and one is a mystery house that'll really test their sense of adventure. So, time to get going, and first on the list is house number one.
How do your families feel about this move? Because you are going a little bit away from home, albeit sort of just over the border.
I'm originally from Lancashire, so it's a bit of a little bit of a trek anyway to where we are at the moment in Staffordshire. But I think they'd quite like it really to come and visit.
It would be ideal if there's a potential for people to stay and stop. But we can always find ways around that. You know, we've got our camper van, which is always a spare bed if we need to be. We don't mind sleeping outside if the guests have got to sleep inside.
Yeah.
We're pretty adaptable.
For our first property, we're throwing caution to the wind and travelling to the northwest of the county to the village of Morda, near the town of Oswestry and the Welsh border, but further away from their work in Nosal. Named after the River Morda, the village is on the outskirts of the market town of Oswestry. The gateway to Wales, medieval Oswestry is known as a centre for trade from both sides of the border, and reminders of this are still evident with its array of textile craft and local produce stores. Just out of Morda village is our first house, a 2-bedroom character cottage in an idyllic location adjacent to a wooded area and stream.
Let's start here. Come on in, guys. This is a good spot to take it all in. There you go. Property number one, Wendy.
It's fantastic.
I'm liking the size of it. Yeah, it looks really good.
Now, it used to be 2 cottages, but now it's 1. Sure. So you get a detached building.
Wow.
It looks really nice.
Yeah.
I'm not sure quite where we're going to put all the outdoor stuff yet.
Yeah.
Well, there is a little shed over there.
Yeah.
But you also get that garage there.
Oh, wow.
OK.
Now, that could be improved upon and made a bit bigger.
Yeah.
Is this the sort of thing that you might have had in mind, Wendy?
Yeah, definitely.
It's certainly a lot bigger than I thought that we'd be able to afford.
Good. Right. Let's see what you think of the inside. Yeah. Come and have a look.
A good start with the location, but already the question of outside space for their mountain of equipment has been raised. So it remains to be seen if the interior of this cottage can redress the balance.
Right, let's start with this one. Come on in. Watch your head, Ross. What do you think?
It's nice. I like it. It's compact. Mm. I like the unusual shape of the room.
There used to be a fireplace there. There would have been a chimney on this end of the roof.
Yeah.
But the flue is still in there. So if you wanted to, open that up, a really nice focal point with a wood burner in it.
Mm. I can imagine it'd be nice and snug in here with a proper fireplace.
Yeah.
It would feel a lot more authentic, more in keeping.
Yeah, definitely. It's quite small, isn't it?
Well, I was brought up in a cottage, so I'm used to low ceilings. So I'm not too bothered about the ceilings. Okay. It's just...
Size-wise.
Yeah, the shape of the room. But it's interesting. I like it.
Good. Well, it does go on. There's a sort of dining room through here. Mm-hmm. Could be a kind of a snug if you wanted it to be.
Sure.
Yeah.
But it does also lead through to the kitchen, which is really lovely, which is in here. I think you'll like this.
Yeah.
Yeah?
It's quite a surprise, isn't it?
It's nice. Nice and new, nice and fresh, granite tops. Mm. I imagine this is your sort of thing. It's quite, you know...
It's got everything there, hasn't it? You know, it's got everything we need.
I think we'd probably like it a little bit more open, wouldn't we?
Yeah, if it was maybe opened up a little more, a bit more social space, so if we did have friends round, that would be good. It's a really interesting property. I like the features that are in here.
To get you closer to the environment you want to be in, it's certainly a good option.
Yeah. It's certainly halfway house, definitely.
Halfway house. Let's find the other half of it. Come on, it's upstairs.
Not the worst reaction, but still, space is the key here. Upstairs, the family bathroom with a modern four-piece suite serves the two double bedrooms, one bright and airy with views to the front, and the other slightly larger, possibly the master.
This, I would suggest, would be your room.
That's nice.
I like the quirky shape of it.
It's really light as well with the two windows.
Got a nice view out down the small little valley.
Oh, it's quiet and peaceful. I mean, it's a lovely room. Mind you, so is the one next door.
Yeah.
So, you could try them both.
It's a really nice shape. It's a similar size to what we've got at the moment, so the size wouldn't be an issue. I'm not so sure about the storage.
There's a bit of built-in here. Mm. There's a little cupboard over there. Again, for two people, you have a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
How you accommodate that, really, I think, is up to you.
Sure.
Yeah, different, which is what we're definitely looking for.
Yeah. The style, isn't it?
Shall we finish off outside?
Sure.
Okay.
After you.
The surrounding gardens are made up of three separate lawns along with secluded decking seating areas. To allay their fears over space, I might have something up my sleeve.
I know space inside you felt perhaps was a little limited, particularly in the living room. There has been planning granted, it's now lapsed, but the precedent is there, to extend it this way, which would extend the kitchen and give you an upstairs third bedroom as well, should you need it. So... has anybody got a figure in mind as to what property number one is worth?
I'm thinking around about 200,000.
200,000?
I was thinking maybe 210.
210? Well, interesting. It's on the market at £218,000.
Okay.
But, having spoken with the owner, I would imagine your budget would secure it.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Mm. Yeah, it's interesting. There's a lot to think about.
Yeah, definitely.
There's plenty to go at, and it's something that we could move straight into. I'm just not sure about the space outside for everything that we have at the moment.
Right then, you've got plenty to consider. Mm. Off you go, and I'll catch up with you later.
Thank you.
Okay, cheers. Thanks.
Enjoy.
This charming character cottage on the market for £218,000 is ideally located for weekend trips to Wales, giving them two decent-sized double bedrooms, a modern oak kitchen with a stylish range, separate dining room, the possibility to extend, and it's all set in an idyllic, peaceful village location.
My first impression was the location. It was brilliant walking up the lane and seeing the house. It was a lovely setting, so I really like that. I could see myself living in this house. It's the exact style that we like. It's just if it's big enough, that's the only problem.
It looks really nice from the outside. Then when we ventured further in, it was a little narrower than it appeared from the outside. I like the location, really nice valley, but I'm just not sure on the amount of outdoor storage space.
I think this was a good start, but there are two more to come,
including
the mystery. Shall we?
Yes.
Come on.
Go.
Despite its industrial past, historically Shropshire has been exclusively agricultural, with sheep farming and the trade in wool the mainstay of the rural economy. The Shropshire breed, around since 1882, was developed for its excellent fleece, ideal for hand-knitting yarn because of the length, thickness and spring of the fibre. Mindful of Wendy's cottage industry and knitted products, we arranged for them to meet local textile weaver Fiona Nisbet, who's offered to show Ross and Wendy how a wealth of countryside bounty can be used in natural wool dye.
This afternoon, what I thought we'd do is I'm going to show you how to do some natural dyeing. I'm going to use Shropshire fleece.
Fantastic.
And then I'm going to colour it using plants that I've collected from the hedgerows.
Yeah, okay.
And some from the garden. Now, having washed it, I then boiled it for about 2 hours in a solution with aluminium sulphate, which is a fixative for the dye. And then I've prepared some dye plants to use for dyeing. This one here is cow parsley.
Yep.
So I've soaked it overnight and then boiled it for about half an hour to get this colour out. This one in here, they're dandelion heads. So I just went down the lane just to collect dandelion heads. And then in here, this is stinging nettles, which I've collected from the garden. But it's just like boiling cabbage. You put water in with it and stew it up.
The soaking time depends on the raw material. Willow twigs or bark would need longer to extract the dye. Once the dye has been removed, the liquid is strained into a bowl. The fleece is added to the dye bath, squeezing the wool to make sure the dye is evenly distributed.
And then we just cook that for about half an hour.
Yeah.
And then it should turn a richer yellow colour than
right.
that.
Right.
Started to turn already.
Yeah, you can see.
And is that quite a permanent dye now?
It is, although it's permanent in the sense that it's dyed permanently on here. It's wash fast, but it's not very light fast. There are three native dye plants which I use a lot: madder root, weld, and woad.
Okay.
The madder root actually looks like this. So this is some that I've dug out of the garden.
And you just boil that.
If you keep the dye pot to a simmering temperature, you'll get lovely pinks. If you let it boil, then you get coral colours, more orangey coral colours. There are lots of different plants that you grow in the garden that you can use to get colour from. But then there are some that you'd expect to get colour from, like beetroot and red cabbage. You know, when you boil it up, you get lots of colour coming out into the saucepan. Mm-hmm. And those colours just aren't, they aren't strong enough. They might colour the wool to start with, but they will fade very, very quickly. The colours always go together. That's the lovely thing about natural dyeing. So no matter what plant you use, whether you're getting greens or yellows or reds, they all go together nicely and they fade together as well.
Fiona incorporates her naturally dyed wool in a variety of products, from rugs to wall hangings, all made in her workshop using traditional weaving methods. Inspiration, perhaps, for Wendy's own creative aspirations. With Shropshire's rural crafts catching Ross and Wendy's imagination, let's hope our houses do too, as our property hunt continues. For house number two, we're travelling east to the village of Morton Say, near to the town of Market Drayton, and a more central location around halfway between Nosal and Wales. Market Drayton itself has been a prosperous market town since the 13th century. Evidence of its success are the many brick structures dating back to the Stuart, Georgian and Victorian periods, with the occasional half-timbered Tudor building. Today it continues to thrive as a centre for trade, with a diverse array of independent shops and characterful streets. Just outside Morton Say, down a quiet country lane, lies house number two, a two-bedroom Victorian semi-detached cottage surrounded by open countryside.
That's what I want you to take in. What do you think?
I like it.
It looks really sturdy. I like the brickwork.
Yep.
I like the space out the front. That's the first thing I've noticed.
Well, that's the real bonus here that we didn't have with the first one.
Yeah.
As you can see, you've got a double garage there, timber frame garage. Plenty of footprint there.
Yeah,
Ross, to make that even bigger. A couple of little sheds over there. The garden we'll have a look at a bit later on. That's all very pretty, very flat. There's an extension on the side here, and actually, you know, that could be made more of. It is a semi-detached, as you probably realise, looking at that hedge line. The neighbours have also added on at the back, so the omens are good if you want to extend this.
We're off to a flying start with the exterior, which satisfies their need for outside storage space, and I'm hoping the character features inside can keep the smiles on their faces. Let's start with the kitchen.
I like the range.
Yeah.
There's plenty of space in
more
here.
Space.
Plenty of head height.
Yeah.
Yes, and the doors.
Yeah.
It's got a lot of features already that we're looking for.
I mean, it's probably about 1850 onwards, this building, and lots of those lovely Victorian features are still here. That's the little extension, which has become something of a breakfast room, which is, again, pretty useful, but you could make that a little bit bigger
if you wanted to. So
it is, I suppose, a sort of kitchen diner-esque
arrangement. Quirky was something that you said you wanted.
Yeah,
I think this has got a bit of quirk.
Yeah, it's certainly different.
Definitely, full of character. It feels really good, this place, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just that sort of thing. It's kind of nice and remote.
Yeah.
It's got all the features we're looking for and the space outside. Yeah, I'm interested to see a bit more.
Well, the features go on. Just have a look at the living room. Look at that. Nice little built-in original cupboard, the wood burner.
Brilliant.
Fantastic.
Yeah?
Yeah, that log burner would certainly keep you warm.
It would. It's enormous. It's an absolute whopper, that one.
It's a good size room as well.
Yeah. Yeah, it feels like there's plenty of space in here.
This is more of an estate farmworker's cottage.
It's got a robust kind of agricultural feel about it, which is what we do like.
And Alfie, down there, in front of the log burner.
Perfect.
Yeah, I'm sure he'd like it. You'd struggle to move him, I think.
Right, let's go upstairs.
Fantastic.
Right to here.
So far, so good, with more positive reactions as the period features seem to be doing the trick. The family bathroom that serves the two bedrooms has an original Victorian cistern, and there is more character to see in the master.
This is for you.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Great.
Yeah?
Yeah, I like it. I like the views out the window, that's brilliant.
Well, I did tell you, you know, you wanted a bit of Shropshire. There it is.
Yeah.
That's nice too.
Yeah,
the old grate.
Definitely. The old grate. I like the two windows as well.
Yeah, the double aspect is nice.
I mean, size-wise, does this improve on what you've already got?
Yeah, definitely. A lot lighter.
Sure. Yeah, I really like it. The high ceilings are really nice as well.
Yeah.
Just gives it that open feel.
Yeah.
Yeah, it feels bigger, doesn't it?
Now, obviously, next door, you know, there is the box room. That's your bedroom too.
Yeah.
We're struggling on bedroom size here, but we're gaining out there.
Yeah.
That's the story of this property.
And that's what we're looking for.
So is that a compromise that you'd be prepared for?
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, I think so. I think so. We could maybe, if we needed to, steal a little from the bathroom if that was if it was a problem. The period features are gorgeous.
Definitely. Yeah.
Good. Look at the smiles on your face. This is all good, Wendy.
I like it.
Yeah.
Right then.
Fantastic.
Let's get back outside.
Okay.
After you, Ross.
The grounds of the property are the big selling point for Ross and Wendy. As well as the garage, they have a half share of an original Victorian outhouse, currently used as a wood store that could be ideal storage space for their climbing equipment. And there's more to see in the garden.
But how about all this?
Great.
What do you reckon?
I like it,
yeah. I mean, you've got quite a bit of ground here.
Yeah, I like it. I like the space. I like the way you've got the hedgerows. Maybe bring those down slightly to improve the view.
Yeah.
No, I like the sort of ruggedness of it.
Yeah, you could have a lot of fun out here, I think, and make it as pretty or as rugged as you like.
Mm.
You know, most of the time we are away in Wales or if in the Lake District, so, you know, shrubs and hedges are better for us than a formal garden.
Yeah. Mm. So, madam, how much is it worth?
Oh, I'll go first. I think it's going to be a little bit less. I don't know, 195 maybe.
Maybe.
I don't know.
So crossing a few fingers. Yeah. Okay. Ross.
I have no idea.
I think we're going to have to go for 200 again. I think it's about 200,000.
Yeah. It's actually on the market for 206,000.
Ah.
Okay.
And I suspect that 6,000 is there to be negotiated.
Mm. Yeah.
So, you know, I think it comfortably comes within your budget. And although it won't leave you with huge amounts left over, I think you'd certainly be left with enough change to make the garage bigger. And if in time you decided to invest in the property and do something about the kitchen, copy the neighbour's extension, you know, you may think that's something worth doing in the future.
Yeah, some added value.
Yeah, exactly. I think this is more you, if I'm honest.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, Helen smiles, say all.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah. Right then, well, I suggest you get out this wind.
Mm.
Go and enjoy yourselves. Have a good look around. Check out some of those storerooms as well.
Cheers.
Okay, cheers.
I'll find you later.
Okay.
Off you go.
On the market for £206,000, this quirky Victorian cottage with period features comes in just under budget and gives them two bedrooms. A characterful living room, the possibility to extend the property further, a garage for the kit car and dinghy, and outbuildings for their mountain of outdoor pursuits equipment. And it's all set in a peaceful rural location off the beaten track.
We could fit the kit car in here.
and maybe adapt it for the boat.
Yeah, it is really good, isn't it? Yeah,
it's the workshop that I've perhaps always wanted.
I really like this place. It's very different to what I probably would have looked at. I'm excited because it's actually possible to make changes here, whereas the last property, you were very limited with that. I think you could make this into a home very easily. Yeah, we could put our own touch to it.
I'm really excited about the potential this property offers us. We've got loads of space outside, nice period features. So yeah, there's definitely a lot here for us to look at. I could definitely see myself living here. I like this house a lot.
After you, madam. After you, sir.
Thank you.
Well, I think that was well worth a visit.
Definitely.
Yeah.
It was really good.
Look at the smiles. It's all good, isn't it?
It is.
Can we improve on this one?
Oh. I'm not sure. Maybe.
Have we got a treat for you?
We're halfway through our property search with Ross and Wendy from Nosal, Staffordshire, who have £210,000 to spend on their rural relocation. Coming up, the mystery house leaves them gobsmacked.
Bit stuck for words, really.
And I release my inner blacksmith.
Right, I'm going to upset my iron.
Well, two down and one to go. It means, of course, that it is almost mystery house time. Now, throughout my conversations with Ross and Wendy, they have alluded to the idea that they're quite prepared to take on a bit of a project, tackle some DIY and roll their sleeves up, possibly with the help of family and friends. Well, our mystery house is going to be a real test of how big their family is and just how many friends they've really got. Well, we have one more property to come, and that is our mystery house. Any ideas what we might have lined up for you?
No idea.
We're hoping for something a little different.
Yeah.
It's different. It's very different. If you do fancy it, this is the key.
Wow.
To the mystery house. How about that?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'm liking the look of it already.
Okay.
Definitely.
For the mystery house, we're heading south to the village of Aston Munslow, around 20 minutes from their desired location of Much Wenlock, but an hour's drive to work in Nosal. Nearby is the market town of Craven Arms, which takes its name from a 200-year-old listed coaching inn built on the main road between Shrewsbury and Ludlow. This traditional town serves the local rural area with general stores, pubs, a post office, and even a museum dedicated to the British way of life set in a Victorian market hall.
There is our mystery house.
Wow.
It's brilliant.
Oh, our mystery chapel. I promised you a big key, or two keys, in fact. These get you in to that.
Fantastic.
Now, to say this is a project is a huge understatement. This is going to require lots of imagination and lots of passion.
Yeah.
But obviously that is reflected in its price.
Sure.
But this could be everything you want it to be.
Certainly what we're looking for, a challenge and
yeah,
something different.
And different, yeah.
What it gives you is an enormous amount of space to play with, and it's how we use that space, really, that's the trick to any successful conversion, whether it's a chapel like this or we need a barn. How do we use the space?
Yeah.
And do you want to walk around with those in your pockets for the next however many years?
I like those.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, they fit. They work.
Yeah.
Come on, let's get inside. Okay.
A great reaction, and Ross and Wendy don't seem fazed at all by the prospect of a project. Mind you, they haven't seen the extent of the challenge that lies ahead.
Oh, wow.
Come on in. Now, for goodness sake, just be careful where you stand and what you stand on, for very obvious reasons.
Wow.
Yeah.
I can see a lot of potential here.
Mm. That's a... You know, putting it lightly, really.
Yeah.
The big space.
It is a big space.
It is, as it is, in a state of disrepair, but I can see that, you know, it is only superficial, really.
Well, you're absolutely right. I mean, the thing about it is that structurally, it's all there. I mean, looking at the roof and the timbers, there's no obvious sign of, you know, water coming in or even damp.
to be perfectly honest. I mean, look over there. There are some of the kind of, you know, internal foundations and fabric of the building, those stone walls.
Definitely.
I can see a builder coming in here and within a week having a new floor in. It's just a case of joists. All the bearers are there in the wall. And from there, then, it's a blank canvas, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm. You could have a massive open plan kind of studio, kitchen, diner, living room here.
Yeah.
You could have mezzanine floor above you. You could have the whole thing as one big floor above you. And if you look at these bays between these two lovely cruck beams here, you've got three bays. So you could have a bedroom above us, you could have a bedroom up there, and in the middle, a landing and a bathroom. You know, sky's the limit.
Yeah,
it really is, yeah.
So many different possibilities, isn't there? It's great.
Oh, yeah, it's a bit stuck for words, really.
It's probably the most challenging reconstruction I've ever shown on this series.
It's quite hard to kind of envisage anything right now, but I reckon, a bit more of a look around and you could start to kind of see a bit of a layout and where you put things.
I'm intrigued to see more. Mm-hmm.
There's the undercroft down there, which we'll go to next, and then there's a bit of garden area below it. But to get to that, we've got to go outside.
Sure.
But if you rebuilt it, my suggestion is that you'd have some kind of stairway going through there, or maybe even a spiral staircase.
Mm. Straight down.
But what do we do with that? Who knows? Let's go and have a closer look at it.
Even faced with the realities of this mammoth task, Ross and Wendy seem excited by the possibilities the chapel will give them, and the downstairs adds another dimension.
This is why there are two keys for this little door as well. There you go. It's a much bigger space.
Yeah, bigger than I thought it would
be. Than you probably would have thought.
I like it.
I think it would make a really good kitchen space.
Yeah.
That was my initial thought.
It's good.
Yeah. Be really good. And you'd have, you know, quite an interesting sort of stairway coming down through here.
Yeah.
Into what would be a really good, big, you know, quite cosy sort of kitchen diner. I mean, can you picture what this could look like?
I think I can a little, yeah.
Yeah, I can see the work surfaces round here and maybe a table in the middle. Mm-hmm. The mezzanine floor, I like the idea of that.
Yeah.
Sure.
Especially with the windows at either gable end. I think that'll let the light in and it could make some really nice features.
Yeah, definitely. I can see little bits already.
This is exciting. Yeah. This is really exciting because your vision is now coming across to all of us. I like it. Any ideas on that price yet?
Oh, I have no idea.
Keep thinking. Keep figuring it out. Come on.
With their minds whirring as to what they can do with the chapel, time to give them something else to think about. Outside space.
Right, just before we get to the garden, which is really at the lower end behind the chapel, this area here obviously is potentially kind of parking space.
Yeah.
But again, could be, I don't know, a bit of storage space.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at it, it is almost wide enough to fit two cars, maybe the boat and a car.
I think it's bigger than we probably think it is.
The garden has a terraced area that could house a shed as a further storage option.
Genuinely, what do you think at the moment?
I think first impressions were it's going to be a big project, but when you look around, it doesn't seem that big of a challenge, really. It's very doable.
You do seem both very optimistic, which is good.
Yeah, I think it's an exciting opportunity. My main worry is the space outside.
Yeah.
The work inside doesn't actually bother me.
Yeah, the price is really going to dictate whether this is a goer or not. So you've got 210 grand to spend.
Yeah.
Ross, your turn.
Good.
Make us an offer on the mystery house.
Looking along the lines of how much I think it would be to renovate.
Yeah.
I'm thinking 160.
Yeah.
Maybe a little bit less. 140.
140, she said, plucking a figure out of the air.
Yeah.
Well, you're both pretty much close to it.
Mm.
Our mystery house that needs an awful lot of TLC is on the market for £150,000.
In the middle. Mm.
It would leave you with a reasonable chunk left over to really get it up and running in pretty short order, actually.
It's a, I'm really excited.
Yeah.
I need to have a closer look, I think.
Yeah. It's good.
Well, let's spend a bit of time here. Come on, let's get out of this weather.
Fantastic.
Let's go.
Well under budget at £150,000, the Mystery House offers them the chance for a major project, giving them full planning permission to create a three-bedroom home. Character features such as vaulted ceilings and stained glass windows, a car parking area for two cars, and it's set in an attractive and quiet village location in an elevated position with views over the glorious Shropshire countryside.
The prospect of renovating this building doesn't frighten me in the slightest. I've got a lot of opportunities with help from friends and parents, but I could turn this into something really spectacular. It just depends whether it's got the outside space for me, I think. That's the only thing, my consideration.
Renovating this, I think, would be loads of fun. It doesn't scare me at all. Could see ourselves living here. There's just loads of potential, and I think we could make it into a real special place.
Well, chaps, that's it. Time to go. Take your thoughts and your hopes and aspirations with you. Think about all the properties we've shown you, and we'll catch up with you a little later.
Okay.
Come on, this way.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There you go. Now, if our property tours have inspired you to want to move to Shropshire, here's a little taste of what's on the market right now.
Modern four-bedroom houses like this near the village of Wixall could suit the average budget, open to offers in the region of £250,000. If you've a little more to play with, then this detached six-bedroom Edwardian house in the market town of Wem could fit the bill. Full of period features, it's on the market for £365,000. And if you're keen on the total countryside experience, then how about this restored four-bedroom farmhouse, including character oak beams, with a guide price of £499,000. Although Shropshire's factories and furnaces of the great industrial age have long since disappeared, the legacy of working with metal can still be found here. With a handful of artist blacksmiths still forging a living in the county, I've come to meet one of them, Roy Abbott.
Roy!
Hi, good to see you.
Nice to see you, sir. This is lovely, isn't it? Tucked away in the Shropshire hills.
Hey, what?
Yes. Now then, blacksmithing, something that's always fascinated me, one of the great ancient crafts, I suppose. But there's a lot to it. It's not just horseshoes, is it?
Not anymore, no.
What are we going to try and create?
Well, I think the ideal thing for you would be to demonstrate how to make a poker, and then you can get your hands dirty. And
that would be a very useful thing to take home. Yeah, brilliant. Right then,
come
let's
on,
get started.
Get your safety glasses on.
These for me? Lovely.
Before I get stuck in, Roy is going to show me the process by making a ram's head poker. To work the iron, he needs to heat the metal to a temperature of at least 1200 degrees centigrade. From the block of red-hot steel, he first draws out the iron, tapering it to roughly the right length for a poker. He then cuts one end to make two spikes for the horns and plunges it into water, known as quenching, to harden the metal. He then bends it over and cleans the metal using a steel brush to remove any impurities before he welds the two surfaces together to make the head. He then punches the end to add the ram's features like nostrils and eyes, bending again and then opening out two prongs that he'll twist to form the ram's horns. Another decorative twist on the neck, and next comes the upsetting, the term for fattening the end by bashing it on the anvil before hammering into a point.
There you go.
Brilliant, Roy. There you are, look. That's what you call a red-hot poker. That's my go.
I'll be using the same techniques as Roy, but I'm going to tackle something a little simpler. First, the drawing out to get the shape.
Keep your hand up.
Yeah, there.
That's it. Lovely. That's right. Now, now when it starts to go that cherry red black, it's time to take another heat.
How long would you leave it in there for?
Till it's hot.
And here's the fancy bit. I'm making a shepherd's crook style poker, so I need to curl the end for the handle decoration.
Got a nice little round scroll.
Now to bend the handle into shape.
That's doing the pulling.
Yeah.
This is guiding.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm really, really chuffed at that.
Make a curtain pole.
How about that? Yeah.
And time to get upsetting.
I love the idea that you can upset mild steel.
Absolutely, without even shouting at it.
Just straight down.
Vertically, bash. Really get some weight into it.
Enough?
No, keep going.
and more hammering to finish the end.
Shall I quench it, Roy? Is that the end? Right, in it goes.
Thanks, mate.
Roy, it's a pleasure.
That's been absolutely brilliant. There you are, my very own fireside poker.
Congratulations.
It's great to know that centuries-old skills are alive with craftsmen like Roy, and long may that continue. But for now, it's time to return to our property hunt and find out if our couple have come to a decision.
Well, Ross and Wendy clearly have high hopes for this move, so having given them plenty of time to consider all that we have shown them, we've now arrived at that part of the show when we find out what happens next.
Well, guys, it's been a very hectic run around Shropshire, hasn't it? Ross, do you think we've got close to finding a solution for you with this move?
Yeah, I believe you have, yeah. I think you've got... you've presented us with quite a few different options, but, yeah.
Some of them quite extreme.
Yeah.
So would you take on Mystery Chapel?
It would be a brilliant project, but we feel that it would be lacking on the outside space.
Yeah.
You could change the interior, you can make it into something amazing.
Our first property was, I thought, something of a safe bet. My guess is that of the three, the favoured option is property number two.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be the one that we feel that we could do the most with. The outdoor space was perfect for us, had loads of potential, loads of space for us to put all of our different things in there.
Yeah.
And it also had some potential to develop it as well, so we liked that one.
It didn't feel like it was a semi-detached. It was really odd because it was there were big rooms and a lot of space.
So what happens next?
I think we'd like to go back out and have a look, spend a bit more time, talk to the neighbours about what they've done with their extension and see what sort of more potential there is there for us to do.
I think it offers you better value for money, without a doubt. Well, here's to you then. Best of luck.
Thank you.
With your possible move. Go back, have another look at property number two, and if you manage to get it, let us know.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, it was brilliant, really. Thank you.
As I said at the very beginning of this show, I love coming to Shropshire. Its stunning mix of landscapes, clear cultural identity, and rich history have all combined to produce a property market that never disappoints, whatever your budget. As Ross and Wendy have proven, you don't need to be a millionaire to move to the countryside. You just need a motive. So the question is, what's yours? Who knows, maybe next time it could be you escaping to the country. Ross and Wendy return to the second property, and while they love the house and grounds, they've reluctantly concluded that the location isn't quite where they want to be after all. However, if you would like to escape to the country in Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland or England, or maybe even further afield to the continent and would like our help, then please apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.
Escape to the Country is back tomorrow at 3. Tonight at 8 for Phil, things go from bad to worse in EastEnders. And next today on BBC One, a former Queen Vic landlady, Anita Dobson talks telly with Brian Connolly, the TV that made me.